Okay, here we go.
Sure.
Can you do your name and a brief kind of rundown for us?
Okay, my name is Jim Slattery. I'm from Norton, Massachusetts. I was one of the founders of the EMS Museum, which NEMT, which I was on the board of directors there. Jerry Johnson, their president, delegated in, I think, 13 years ago, you do the arithmetic, that they wanted to set up a museum, a national museum, and the EMS to the Rescue Museum in Roanoke was closing and they needed a depository. So Bob Loftus and I and Jules Scadden were appointed, and we started the museum, and then we got Lou Jordan involved, and he got the whole world involved, and we are a semi-successful organization in this day.
Excellent. How about your EMS background?
My EMS background is I started in EMS in 1958. I started because I was in ski patrol. I had to take a standard first aid course. My town ran the ambulance through the police department. When I got into high school, the police department found out I was first aid trained. They used to come to the high school, call me out of class. I jump in the police cruiser and take off at the age of 16, 15. And the principal got very upset that I had to keep leaving school. In the early 1970s, when EMS decided to go from first aid, at least in Massachusetts, they required standard first aid, or advanced. They went to the EMT program. The state of Massachusetts was running three programs. I was a CPR instructor and a first aid instructor. Being an instructor, I knew that if you have 30 people in a class, only 25 are going to show up. I put my name in for a couple of the three classes run by the state. I was not accepted for whatever reasons. I went to one of the instructors and I said, listen, I want to get into your class. He says, we're full. I said, listen, I think that I can, let me tutor the class for a couple of weeks. If nobody fills, let me fill that seat. And they let me do it. So I actually took the last free class in Massachusetts, I believe in 1973.
Very cool.
And I worked as a police officer on the police department as an EMT. Then I became president of the union, was a Navy veteran, went to a small town police department where the chief was not educated, not a veteran, didn't like the union, so I had three strikes against me. He and I did not get along for a long story that we don't have time for. He managed to get me off the department, and I didn't fight to stay on because if he didn't want me, he didn't want me. But I was deeply involved in EMS anyway. The day I was laid off, a guy from a private ambulance company called me up and said, we're getting the city of Taunton, Massachusetts contract in a month. I would like you to work on that contract. I was in the city of Taunton for 39 years for four different private contractors. The last contractor was American Medical Response. I was there until I turned 70. American Medical Response did not have a retirement plan. And I was in the government retirement plan that after 70, you don't get any more money. So it was a nice time to leave. So I retired. Quirk of that was AMR laid me off because I was, before I was going to retire, because they closed my office. So I was able to collect unemployment for 6 months. And I made $2,000 a month more than when I was working.
Oh my gosh.
Between Social Security and unemployment. But I got deeply involved in NEMT. I was on their board of directors for 30 years. They pushed me into the museum. I've been here from the start. I consider myself and a couple other people the worker bees. We're not financially able as being street EMTs to support the museum the way we should. But if you need somebody to man a museum, if you need somebody to run somewhere, drive somewhere, I mean, I've driven to New Jersey, Washington, D.C., New York, New Hampshire, Delaware to man a museum booth. I'm not afraid to go anywhere. I'll donate my time and my gas. I can donate my services versus the money. So that's how I support the museum, and I think everybody else should support the museum.
Awesome. Did anybody inspire you to get into first aid EMS?
I think who inspired me, because that was, this probably isn't fair to say, but that was on the questionnaire of what questions were going to be asked. And all I can say is it's sort of a family tradition of public service. My father was on the finance committee in my hometown. I was very politically involved. I helped John F. Kennedy in his congressional campaigns. I helped him in his presidential campaigns. We were friends of the family. I helped Ted and everything else. So I had some public service stuff. My grandfather owned the biggest mill in the small town in Massachusetts I lived in. He donated the land the fire department put on because it was a self-insurance policy, because you give the building for the fire department, where's the fire trucks going to be? So he wasn't exactly stupid, except when he passed away, they never deeded the fire department building to the town. We had to sell in his estate the building to the town for a dollar. So he was on the fire department. He became a lieutenant. My cousin became the chief. My public service, public safety, started out with the forest fire department in town when I was 12. We used to be the experts in the area for putting out forest fires or grass fires. My cousin elevated himself to chief of the fire department. For some stupid reason, I chose to go the police department route, then got into private ambulance work. So my inspiration was probably my grandfather indirectly, and maybe my father because of his public charitable work. I mean, I've been involved in the Red Cross, I've been a chapter chairman, and I was president of the state EMT association. So I've done all these non-paying jobs, and public charitable work is what I do. So.
Yeah, that's amazing. Do you regret not going into the fire like everybody else?
The only thing I regret is not fighting the police chief, because I really would have liked to have been a police chief. Because I was doing, I'm trying to think what it was, the kids and the public safety stuff, community policing, in 1960. I got a BS degree in teaching, but all the teaching jobs were gone because I went to Vietnam, and the people who didn't go to Vietnam got the teaching jobs. I came back. The only thing open was the police department, so I went there. But I substitute taught in the schools, so I had a relationship with the kids. So I was doing this community policing in the 60s. That's another reason the police chief didn't like me, because he came from the old school where you ruled with a billy club and nobody liked you. Well, I ruled with a voice and education, and the kids, I mean, I got a million stories about what the kids did. I mean, one of them came dressed up as Santa Claus to my house, and I love telling this story. My two daughters were in the bathtub. They were like 4 and 6 or something, so the moral equity of that doesn't work out. But walked in as Santa Claus, and the first thing my wife did was call me. She goes, I got a kid here dressed as Santa Claus with a wine stain in the middle of his beard. So, you know, I got along with the kids. It worked in the police sense, because if somebody broke into your house, I could go to the kids and go, who broke into, we had somebody break into my house and stole the Girl Scout cookie money. I knew who it was within 2 days. I go to the detective department and go, listen, you go find John Doe. He's the one that probably, you'll go to his car, you'll find in the back seat somebody's TV or radio or whatever. And they go, who's your source? And I says, I'm not giving out my sources. You just go to him. So, I mean, I really liked it. I'm a little outspoken. I was outspoken on the EMT board. I'm still on the state healthcare committee. I'm known as being very verbose. But people who know me get used to my personality. And I guess deep down, there's a good point to it. Somebody has to break the ice. Somebody has to ask the question. When the person goes at the end of a meeting, are there any questions? Somebody has to ask a tough question. And that's me.
Excellent. 1 second.
I'm not. You don't really mean that.
No, I do. Polite. Nope. Absolutely. Talk away. Any other police stories you want to share?
No, I mean, the guy called me up for the private ambulance to be on the private ambulance, and it gave me, you know, I have the public sector view, and this is probably going back to the National EMT Association stuff, but they are multi-representative of different types of EMS. private, public, union, non-union, fire-based, third-party, helicopters, and I think I got a better perspective of that. And when I got the most favorite story, and I don't know if this is one of the questions I like to tell, is I was elected EMS director for Region 5 in Massachusetts. Now, I work for American Medical Response, private ambulance service. I was elected by the fire chiefs. And anybody who's watching this video and knows anything about EMS, the fire departments and private ambulance service are not warm and fuzzy people. They will get along when they have to because we're all a big family. But everybody thinks the private service wants to take away the ambulances from the fire department. And I've always said from day one, ambulance justifies your fire department. Anybody who wants to argue with that, just look at your statistics of your run volume or the side of your truck that got changed from fire department to fire rescue. So, you know, the NAEMT gave me that wide perspective, and I really, you know, people look at me and I love telling the story that I got elected Region EMS director by the fire chiefs, and they just shake their head that that shouldn't happen. And I actually stayed working for AMR because I didn't want to get the lower pay of being Region EMS director.
That's awesome. What was training like when you started?
Well, like I said, it was standard first aid, the old green book. Actually, it was brown, I think. Then we went to the green book. Then we went to the white advanced first aid. I did take my first EMT course, Harvey Grant, which had the old yellow book. I don't know who else he taught with, but he was one of my instructors. He used to wear a yellow jumpsuit all the time, and he used to look like a big parakeet. But when we go into the junkyards to do extrication, it was hilarious. But, you know, that's how we start out. And I felt, and this goes back to being EMS director, that being an EMT was all you needed to be. I did not want to become a paramedic because I was worried about skill deterioration because of not seeing enough people. I don't, being a realistic street person, I realize that 20% of the people we see every day are really sick. The other 80% just need compassion and a uniformed trained professional to show up. And psychological, we do more psychological care by being present than we do physical care. And so I never became a paramedic, which is another surprising thing. Half the people call me paramedic, but I'm not. I stayed in intermediate, I continued my care, and I started to take the advanced course, and then I retired. The education is coming along. Now they have community health care, which I think is very good. The state of Massachusetts is putting a few roadblocks up. I'm fighting to stop those roadblocks, but we will get it done because not everybody needs a $1,500 ambulance bill and a $5,000 ER visit when somebody can say to you, take two aspirin and call me in the morning.
Awesome. All right. What was your ski patrol training like?
Ski patrol was interesting. They do outdoor emergency care. When we first started out, it was all Red Cross because Red Cross was nationally recognized and Ski Patrol is throughout the United States. So it was a national course that they didn't have to worry about. But some of the geniuses at the top, the administrative people, we know how they worked, decided that Ski Patrol should have their own course because Canada had their own Ski Patrol course. So they had John Clare from New York took an EMT book, throw it out in the snow, and as the snowflakes went in each page, it became the OEC manual. So they evolved into being equal to EMTs. And a lot of people don't realize that. They think they're first responders.